Judge Sciarra, dear Silvana, it is my great pleasure to welcome you back to the EUI and its law department this afternoon. I'd like to say a few introductory words that will not take too long, that relate to you and the time you spent here as a law professor from 1994 to 2003. First, on where here was and is. Second, on changing gender balance within the department. And third, and most importantly, perhaps, on the substance and approach of your scholarly work. First, our physical location. The here of then is not the here of now. This is not the environment that you knew back in your days at the EUI. The move from the beautiful Villa Skiffenoia that you knew so well was unexpected for the law department, more than a little traumatic for those who had to straddle both. But given the turnover within the EUI, both of researchers and of faculty, there are not so many anymore that still bemoan the days in beautiful Villa Skiffenoia, which in fact is over the hill and you can still visit. Some of you even still have your office there, the joint chairs, that is. So in particular for the first year researchers, I show the photograph because this was traditionally the law department's location. So we moved a few years ago to a possibly more beautiful castle and villa that is less cozy for sure, but nonetheless, even in COVID times, a substantial building capable of providing refuge and safe physical presence, even in these difficult times, as it has undoubtedly done many times over the past centuries of its existence. Second, gender. While you were at the EUI, one of your many activities was to direct what was then known as the EUI Gender Studies Programme. It was interdisciplinary in nature, with an emphasis at that time on gender balance at various levels of academic institutions, and on the need to tackle personal harassment. If I look at some photos from around the time you joined, then this was not a luxury. So maybe we could have the second photograph. I did a little bit of research because not everything is on the web from those times. So I don't know if you can see these, but I thought for you this would be particularly reminiscent. So obviously they're all men with one woman, but you can see, if you note, not only Professor Cassese, but De Hoos is also a law professor at that time, our current president. So that this was 1 year before you were appointed, 1983, very well-known names. But only one woman. And in fact, Professor Kravaritou, I hope I said that correctly, from Greece, and she was the very first woman professor in the law department. And I only heard today, in fact, that there was recognition at the time, there had been a lot of discussion in the preceding years about that there needed to be a female member of the department. And so a special chair was actually created on gender studies, which she filled for many years. And the thinking back then, and it's not so very long ago, was that special measures were needed to include women and make sure they were represented. Very quickly, however, the normalization, what I would term the normalization path started, and you successfully became the new professor of labor law, taking over from the very well-known labor lawyer at the time, Brian Bergerson, when he left and went back to the United Kingdom. I wish I could say that these themes have been resolved 25 years later, but certainly normalization has paid dividends in the law department, and for all of you, it's a non-issue. I mean, there's gender equality in terms of researchers, but also in terms of law professors. In fact, from this September, we are exactly half-half in terms of gender. Last, but certainly not least, I welcome you back as an inspiring and committed researcher and supervisor. Already when you joined the EUI in 1994, you were considered one of the leaders of your generation in your field in Europe. Your PhD thesis was on the workers' councils in Italy, and you already had experience of what we would now call field work, interviewing personnel managers and shop stewards of large Italian companies. From being a legal expert in Italy, you branched more into comparative labor law and comparative methodology, and more broadly into European social law, about which we will hear more shortly from you. And all of that starting in Bari in the south, progressing mainly in and from Florence and with interludes in the United States, United Kingdom, and elsewhere in Europe. In your time at the EUI, you embraced a very wide number of subjects and had a large cohort of PhD researchers in the areas of labor law and social law, many of whom went on to successful academic careers of their own. You also created and ran innovative projects in research and writing, bringing together scholars and practitioners, especially judges from all over Europe and beyond. And this actually is the product of one such book, Labor Law in the Courts, National Judges and the European Court of Justice. And actually, oh yeah, you've already showed the third photograph. And here you are around that time. It was the only one I could find of you, I'm afraid, with two of your colleagues. Again, Renaud de Hoos, but that's coincidental. And actually, I thought this must be an old style graduation ceremony, and that what you were looking at and admiring in a way was a large graduation diploma that apparently had been introduced just around that time. I also only learned that today, what actually the document was that you were admiring. So the turn of the century period of your tenure around the 2000s coincided with a period of dynamism and even optimism for European labor law and social law. And it's good for us to remember the European dream in these days of harsher realities more generally. In your more recent book from 2018, Solidarity and Conflict, European Social Law in Crisis, you speak of European social law, obviously, in crisis, so it's particularly appropriate for us today to look at the longer sweep of history and the contextual factors that were a central part of the EUI's strong reputation in the field of European social law over a 30-year period. Your ability as a scholar is to relate legal developments to wider conceptual and social contexts in a challenging manner. All different existing EU policies scrutinized in your book offer, in your own words, an opportunity to reclaim national democratic traditions and feed again in a positive and constructive discourse on European integration. In fact, in 2018, you conclude your book by speaking of good reasons to look ahead positively and set aside fears and disillusion. This is an important message to all of us today. Thank you so much, Judge Sciarra, for agreeing to open our academic year at a very timely moment for us to remember our dreams of a social Europe here at the EUI and far beyond, and to inspire us all not to trample on our dreams, but to tread very carefully. Thank you. Yes, I invite you to move to the podium, and then you will be safely at a distance from all of us. Yeah, you'll need to use the mic, to turn on the mic. Yeah, and I'll...
Thank you very much. Thank you. It's a very emotional time for me. Thank you for the invitation. Thank you for all of you actually present physically in this room and those who are following this seminar on Zoom. Most people attending this lecture will wonder about the title, which is a little strange. Gonna take a sentimental journey. It's an old American song, and taking a sentimental journey, the song clarifies, it really means to go back home, and the song says to set one's heart at ease. And this is what I intend to do today in my own sentimental journey to the EUI, which I consider home, home even in the pandemics, as it was in happier times. Home because it confirms strong friendships and fortifies the channels of collaboration and communication. So I was particularly pleased to have Professor Curtin chairing this session today, old friendship, which is fortified today. The journey is sentimental because it is linked to places. You saw Villa Schifanoia before, but this is also a place of memories, to people, and to European social law, which I consider my elective field of interest, although I was born as a labor lawyer and a comparative labor lawyer. My current commitment at the Constitutional Court opened up completely new worlds for me, and so there was a new journey that I had to start there. A fascinating journey, a different journey, but this journey makes me think of how privileged I am being able to take contemporary several journeys in my life. I shall mention later on what having been a university professor here at the EUI means to me while that I am a judge at the Constitutional Court. But let me anticipate one point. What I learned here was to really come close to different perspectives, listen to other people's voices, learn different methodology, so be flexible, be open-minded, and I'm very grateful for this because it really allowed me to build up, hopefully, new strength for my new job at the court. I shall offer to you three stops of my journey. It won't be too long. The first stop is social law during the years I spent at the EUI. Then the second stop is a look at the state of the art of social policies in the dramatic time we are undergoing. And then I shall offer you a very personal appraisal of the meaning that EUI had for me and has now as a constitutional judge. The first stop materializes in a wonderful gift I received, and here it is. It's a special issue of a journal that I used to edit many years ago, and I stopped editing when I was elected as a judge. And it's an issue in which some of my supervisees at the EUI decided to write a piece. It was offered to me on my 70th birthday. No reason to hide my age, which is actually more than 70 now. And this is an incredible gift for me. This is the sign of what a collective work can be in this place. I'm not referring to this special issue in a self-referential way, by no means, but as a sign of gratitude to the scholars who have written pieces in this special issue, just to remember their years here at the EUI working on social law. Not only they were at the time excellent researchers, they are now extraordinary professionals. Each of them in his or her own capacity, they are able to influence public opinions, they nourish scholarship, they contribute to policy making in different countries and in different ways. So this is really an opportunity for me to transmit my immense enthusiasm to researchers who are now just starting their own journey. It will become sentimental for them too one day, I hope. And to those who are completing their doctorate studies here, or even to those who are visiting for a short time. It is an incitement to those of you who visit the EUI to enjoy the flourishing of initiatives and the many ideas that circulate in this place. In my sentimental journey, I want to recall that a number of researchers working in European social law were offered in my days, and I'm sure that you still continue to do this, the opportunity to work as a stagiaire in the European Commission. My supervisees mainly went to DG Employment. I know that you now invite people from European institutions. I think this is an incredibly important opportunity for young researchers, because a practical point of view and the drafting of directives, my supervisees, some of them were able to follow the drafting of some social law directives, take part in meetings, learn this secondary law in the process of being made. That was immensely important for them and for me. And so I've read with great interest what Sylvain Lulhomme, one of the people who was as a researcher here in my years, writes in the special issue. She is a professor at Lyon and now an advocate general at the Cour de Cassation in France. She writes, without having full consciousness, we were living at the EUI, the end of the global age of European social law. And I'm thrilled to mention, because I don't want to be too sentimental, that I discovered just by chance that here at the Alcide De Gasperi Research Center, at the EUI, there is a permanent research group on social Europe, which only just started operating and was stopped by COVID, but will start operating again soon, I hope. And what do they write in their little manifesto? They say, the European pillar of social rights, it is the interinstitutional declaration signed by the European Parliament, the Council and the Commission in November 2017, seems to have set in motion a conscious recognition of and a potentially necessary call for the return to a social Europe. And they claim that the important part of this return to social Europe is the involvement of social partners. In fact, in 1996, at the end of his presidency of the Commission, Jacques Delors founded Notre Europe. I think this archive somehow wants to go back to that history and retrace Jacques Delors' immensely important work as president of the Commission. President De Hoes has been an advisor to Notre Europe. We have a think tank there, which is really more than a think tank. It's really a place where ideas are proposed and proposals are actually efficient. And my hope is that the pandemic should not stop the commitment of this special research center. The idea, if I understand correctly, is also to create an archive. And I am very much in favor of tracing the history of social policies. There is, by now, a fairly long history of social policies. So hopefully there will be an opportunity to enhance this idea, and even young researchers may be proposing ideas for this center. Certainly the floor is open now for a subject matter which I think is very topical in the law, has been topical in the law department and is now very much so in these difficult times we go through. And now the department is in the competent hands of Professor Cartin, which I'm sure will even further so to say, enhance the history and the traditions of the law department in social law. What is the state of the art of social law in the pandemics? This is the second stop of my sentimental journey. The Juncker Commission, at the beginning of the mandate of President Juncker, put forward the program based on the pillar, which was initially accepted or talked of with a lot of skepticism. The pillar, principles, they are not rights, a lot of skepticism. But then, at the launch of her mandate, President of the Commission, Ursula von der Leyen, promised to reconcile the social and the market and implement the European Pillar of Social Rights. One of the promises she kept was to start the consultation of the social partners for a European measure on minimum wages. The social partners had not been consulted for a long time, so we were sort of losing track of that important and, I must say, unique tradition comparatively. So minimum wages, consultation, revitalized the social dialogue under Article 154 of the Treaty on the Functioning of the European Union. It's a very sensitive subject. The social pillar recalls most relevant international sources, and a closer coherence with international standard is crucial, I think, at this time of history when we discuss the notion of adequate wages and we frame them in an international economic context. Despite the skepticism of Business Europe, which is really hostile to this proposal, Business Europe is the large association representing employers, and the reluctance of the Nordic unions, they fear to enter this field because they are very protective of their own systems of national collective bargaining. The floor has been opened by Ursula von der Leyen for a discussion, and we're now witnessing the second stage of consultation of the social partners. It is intriguing, and I am sure perhaps this could be the object, if some of you was interested in social law, of some research, because the Commission has a problem with the legal basis of this proposal, should the proposal be, in fact, be put on the floor. There is a potential problem of ultra-virus because wages are expressly kept out of the competence of the treaty. That's Article 153, I think. And the Commission is suggesting that perhaps it could be considered working conditions. There would be a directive indicating binding requirements, which would leave space to member states as for ways to implement them. It's critical. It's a critical suggestion, but it's interesting. It's intriguing to discuss the legal basis of such a proposal. Otherwise, the Commission says, there could be a recommendation to create a common policy framework at the EU level with no obligatory requirement for member states. And this could be an alternative. The very sensitive point here is collective bargaining. As I mentioned before, Nordic unions are very defensive, and the role collective bargaining is going to play in certain countries where there is no statutory minimum wage. Quite a lot of them, Austria, Italy, Cyprus, the Nordic countries. So the Commission is suggesting, where no statutory minimum wages exist, suggesting criteria which are, again, debatable. For example, a percentage of the national median, but this could be problematic for countries with very low wages in some sectors. I suggest the work by Mueller and Schulten, who write for the European Trade Union Institute, the institute attached to the European Trade Union Confederation. They often write for a journal I'm sure most of you receive, which is Social Europe, which is a great source of information. And hence, diversity emerges as a resource in European social law, and yet it's a complication because, for example, Spain adopted recently Ingreso Minimo Vital, June 2020, with the support of cross-industry confederations. But Italy is discussing what to do. There are proposals now on the table of the government to finance statutory minimum wages with the Recovery and Resilience Facility, the recent source we discuss so often. So here comes one of my memories. Hard or soft law? This is the question for a sentimental traveler like me, because many memories come back to my mind, discussions in Villa Schifanoia on similar issues, low wages throughout the EU, had frequently been recalled as one of contentious inheritances of the economic and financial crisis, and fantastic research has been done in this place, mainly conducted by Claire Kilpatrick and Bruno De Witt and many other colleagues here. There have been Council's recommendations during the European semester, often concentrated on such an issue, minimum wages, addressing countries to raise the level of wages. There have been very controversial constitutional court decisions throughout Europe dealing with wages, trying to find criteria of proportionality and adequacy. So really, this is a crucial theme, even now in the pandemics, in the COVID-19 emergency, because in Italy, as in other countries, when it comes to extending protections to marginal workers, among them riders, the ones we see running on the bikes, even during lockdowns, they were pretty much the only ones we could see on empty roads, and other platform workers. But there is now a directive, actually the first hard law measure based on the pillar, so something happened despite the initial skepticism. This is a directive on transparent and predictable working conditions in the European Union, and it is based on the pillar and has to do with situation of unpredictable working patterns and non-standard contracts of employment, with a reflection, of course, on wages. We have read recently in these days in Italy how low the wages of these people are. Wages are also crucial for agile or smart workers. Robert Reich, the former Minister of Labour in the Clinton administration, calls them the remotes, since they often work long hours with the same remuneration, difficult to be paid overtime when you are a remote. So here we have a necessity to move away slowly, whenever it will be possible, from emergency rules towards more adaptable ones in a much expected regained normality. The President of the Commission has also put an emphasis on another measure, and this is the European Unemployment Reinsurance Scheme, a project which was sponsored by a former Italian minister, Minister Padoan, who is also an economist, and was sponsored also by Juncker, by predecessor von der Leyen, and widely discussed in academic circles. A very difficult measure to be adopted, but the COVID-19 sort of imposed a sudden change of maneuver in this project. And so on May 19th, 2020, there was a council regulation on a different measure, and this is the establishment of for temporary support to mitigate unemployment risks in an emergency, SURE. Most people mention this as SURE. I shall do the same, but perhaps it's not the right pronunciation to adopt, but it's quicker. And the scheme is very similar to the European Financial Stability Mechanism, which was established in 2010 in the middle of the economic and financial crisis, in order to provide assistance to countries undergoing serious financial crisis. The idea that we are looking at with great interest, and I think most governments are actually looking at this measure with immense interest, is to provide financial assistance on short notice and to implement work schemes for both employees and self-employed. This is important to underline, self-employed as well, of risk of unemployment because of the pandemics. The legal basis is Article 1221 and 2, the treaty, and principles of subsidiarity and proportionality should be observed in using this fund, which should be accessible under very precise circumstances, namely whenever a relevant increase in public spending is required to counteract unemployment caused by the COVID-19 outbreak. There is no transfers whatsoever of competences to the EU. It is not required. Sure introduces accessible loans in a disruptive situation of emergency. Here I recommend a paper written in Italian by Cilento and Limardo, published on a website journal called Adapt. ETUC is very active in involving the social partners in all that is going to happen under the enforcement of SURE, particularly for short-time work arrangements, which seems to be one of the options on the table. And he's also pressing for putting back on the agenda a scheme for the European Unemployment Reinsurance Scheme, the one I mentioned before. So they don't want to forget the properly called unemployment scheme. SURE is something else. And similar suggestions are made by many economists active in this field. And I quote from some of them, as SURE is potentially a cost-effective automatic stabilizer at the European level, if used properly, it may be the starting point for a more ambitious European unemployment insurance system. Here, Van der Broeke and others have written. And it is interesting because it's like opening up the new path that the unemployment scheme should follow. I argue that this is a crucial time, and I'm happy to say this in this place, for comparative analysis and interdisciplinary analysis to let the best practices of the pandemics emerge. Emergency legislation should be looked at comparatively. For example, we have the German case when we come to short-time work arrangements, which seems to have been successful. But they make sure that they are used for cyclical reasons and not for structural ones in order to prevent negative side effects. Here comes again, for short-time work, the problem of adequacy of wages. And once more, ETUC, the European Union, suggests that low-wage workers should be perhaps more and better protected than the other ones. So they should be more protected because it looks, and I think is true, like the hardest hit by unemployment. So there is another point to scrutinize comparatively. The groups which are most at risk in this time and how protective means can be sort of offered differently if necessary. And then SURE should be anchored, most documents specify this, to the EU Charter of Fundamental Rights. So we should not forget fundamental rights when implementing emergency measures. The scheme of the European semester, which we have been studying with so much attention, the piece written by Claire Kilpatrick in the journal I mentioned, is on governance of the semester. She says the semester brings new opinions and has an effect on public debate, so that is a positive idea of this governance. The scheme of the European semester, as you can see, is still alive and well, we hope. But member states should, in my view, be particularly alert in this time, in this difficult time of history, in keeping an eye on the balance that we want to see among the measures discussed during the semester. And the urgent issue to be considered, in my view, is how to endorse what has been the weakest point, unfortunately, of social law so far. And that's active employment policies, not passive help, not simply passive measures, but active employment policies, how to link them up with an efficient scheme or more than one scheme of training, particularly for young people, and how to meet the demands rising from national labor markets, demands which are dramatically affected by the pandemic. So there should be a way of rethinking new jobs during the pandemics and project active employment policies into the future. And here comes another moment of nostalgia for the present sentimental traveler, because we spent many hours in seminars discussing Europe 2020, which appeared to be a Pandora box, and the open method of coordination read through the lenses of Title IX of the treaty. It was like discovering a new planet. I, of course, have to mention the beautiful book written by Diamond Ashkabor on this subject, which comes out of her thesis written here. But the novelty in these hard times is that there are very strict conditionalities which should force member states into very careful, virtuous behavior. One should say it's always been like that. You know, there were conditionalities in the open method of coordination, but soft law prevailed. I remember lots of discussions, and Professor Curtin's work is very important in this field, on deliberative democracy, the role of civil society. It was an exciting time. But now we are discussing a very urgent need to make active employment policies more binding on member states. In fact, there was already a U-turn from soft law techniques of the first, so to say, phase of the open method of coordination, when the Council, with a decision, this is 2014, addressed member states in view of enhancing coordination through benchmarking, bench learning indicators. There's been a wide criticism in literature on governing by numbers. I remember Simon Deakin, Supiot, criticizing the governing by numbers. But what do you do? How do you enforce this criteria of binding employment policies? The Council adopted a recommendation on the youth guarantee on similar lines to tackle the problem of young people in neither employment, education, or training. There is a discussion now that this measure could be revitalized together with the other measures adopted during the pandemics. But my question is, are emergency measures reducing even further the potentialities of proactive employment measures, which I think is what is most needed now, particularly, I repeat, for young people? Are employment services the right actors? Should we want to see them more visible and more, again, proactive, proposing ideas? Is cooperative federalism that we have learned so much about a possibility? And is trust among national administration still a possibility, a tool to be used towards an end? The Juncker Commission prompted the creation of a new authority, which is called the European Labour Authority, to tackle undeclared work and promote fairness in the market. There is still need to promote fairness in the market, to regulate the mobility of workers. This is a regulation adopted in 2019, but I read with some surprise on the website that this immense new authority, it's really quite plethoric, will not reach its full operational capacity until 2024. Why? What is happening meanwhile? And how should we insist that this activity, if it is a monitoring, if it is tackling undeclared work, should start pretty soon? The authority operates in connection with the public employment services and will replace the Commission in coordinating the network of public employment services. Again, here there was another binding source, another regulation. I'm mentioning this because there was a move from soft law under the Title IX to hard measures and better coordination of public employment services. But perhaps I've been wondering, there are too many actors involved when the urgency is to stabilize all initiatives addressing unemployment, not necessarily identifying them as emergency measures, because we want to see these as stable measures governing the labor market and letting offer and demand meet in an easier way. So So let's not forget that the authority should also take into account third country nationals, legally resident, and long-term residents, according to the EU law regulating their mobility. So how will this machinery be combined, for example, with the other measure I just mentioned, which is sure, the important measure that we're discussing nowadays, and will there be space to include third country nationals in inclusive employment policies? The pandemic could really throw new light on this new authority, which I'm curious to see. I don't want to be critical, but I'm curious to see how it will work, and hopefully pretty soon, and clarify the interaction of the authority with employment services, which are connected in an apparently quite efficient European network. So coordination of social security systems is another issue which the authority should address. One more stone in this building that I'm trying to build up for you, a building of facts, but also a building of hopes. The European Parliament in April 2020 voted a proposal to use uncommitted money from the Cohesion Policy Fund. This is a subject which is very interesting for me. I've always taken an interest in this rather technical subject matter, because it's a very technical matter. You need to find the right administrators at national level. There is this idea of co-financing projects which are supported by structural funds. And now we read that, for example, the European Social Fund, which is a pearl of social law because it's an institution which has always been there ever since the Rome Treaty, and very well functioning, in fact, the European Social Fund, under the current regulation, there is no need to change anything, can be used to acquire, for example, protective devices, guarantee health and safety at work, and more broadly, support measures contrasting the diffusion of the virus. So there is money there available together with all the other measures that I've mentioned. Perhaps in this second stop, which has been a bit longer than the first one, but the third one will be very, very short. I have put too many colors in the pictures, and this may sound a little confusing, but certainly I think the EUI was, in my ears, the place where you could pull together different threads, many more threads than the ones I am mentioning now, because you can look into new initiatives and linking them up with the old measures and trace the history, as I said before. So really, I do believe that synergies of existing policies is perhaps the easiest solution rather than creating continuously new policies. But of course, there is now a very peculiar environment if we want to look at this suggestion of making synergies among different policies. Why? Because policymakers have to be very pragmatic, very quick, but they shouldn't ever lose coherence. That's very important. They should not lose coherence. They cannot distance themselves from one point which is of great value nowadays, and is the respect for the rule of law. And here I come with my third stop, because the third stop is short, also for reasons of time, and in fact, it should be a long stop, and perhaps we should devote, or I should devote, or you maybe can think of a little new journey into the stop. The stop is, in fact, a new journey of its own. Through comparative research on preliminary references to the Court of Justice, and I'm glad that Professor Cartin mentioned the book, which is very dear to my heart, sponsored here at the EUI, we continued in our little disciplinary context, labor law, a tradition which was started in this place by Slaughter, Stone, Sweet, and Weiler, a book published in 1997, But many other scholars in this place, the Us, Poyares Maduro, Miklis, many more that I don't mention now. And now the Center for Judicial Cooperation, which you direct, Professor Cartin. Well, admittedly, I am sentimental, so I've said this many times, so that particular research on labor law in the courts is important for me, because there we had researchers from the EUI who worked together with eminent scholars in the field, and the book was published in close cooperation. And Claire, for example, wrote this important chapter on gender equality. What did it mean to me, that research project? Well, we listened to judges in many seminars. We invited national judges who were, very few of them, were selected by the scholars who wrote in the book. And we had preparatory seminars to the book, listening to judges, listening to their stories, their ways of interpreting the preliminary references, how were they thinking of drafting a preliminary reference. So this is of utmost relevance today because I think we must continue to acknowledge courts, the role that they have throughout Europe today, during the pandemics as well. There have been contentious cases. I'm thinking of the Danish court case, the German court case. Even the Italian Constitutional Court was rather contentious in some decisions. But I have had my little experience in drafting a preliminary reference to the court and published it last July. And I had inside me the memories of that research group and of the many instructive talks and discussions with colleagues here. Let me just recall a chapter written by Bob Eck, who again was a researcher here and now is an advocate general at the Court of Justice. So you see, I mean, there are career paths of great interest starting from this place. In a book which I find rather interesting, published a few years ago, called Judging Europe's Judges, he writes that the legitimacy of the Court of Justice, must be found in national courts because they are the clients of the court. It's true. They are the clients of the court and they are repeat players. They never stop playing the game. They create a context of mutual trust. So this is what I had in my mind in drafting my preliminary reference, which I drafted, but I mean it was jointly decided by my colleagues. So here I am at the end of my journey, although I must say that journey never ends. Journeys are continuous. One hopes to travel all the time. I think this is a good metaphor for research and academic engagement. When one gets somewhere, one immediately starts planning a new itinerary. I hope you will do so. Get there, but then there is a new itinerary ready to be explored. And there are two indispensable items to put in the suitcase. Memories from the previous journey and curiosity to the next one. And this is what I try to do today. And I really thank for the hospitality and for the care of the administration in organizing this meeting in presence. The pandemic really cannot stop my sentimental journey to the EUI, and in fact, it did not stop it. COVID-19 and the outbreak it provoked should lead us towards new solidarities, not emergency solidarities, but solidarities of the emergency. They should be grounded in social dialogue, in consensual institutions, and in permanent learning from one another. And really, my sincere encouragement for all EUI researchers and all visitors in this place is to keep on traveling all the time. Don't stop. Thank you.
Where do you prefer to take questions? Maybe it's more comfortable that you can, but as you prefer. Okay, well, thank you so much for that very inspiring lecture and also clear messages. I would say don't physically travel too much, please. You have a residence obligation in Florence. But nonetheless, I really liked what you said in particular at the end about putting in your package memories. So that also applies to you from where you're coming from now, but also curiosity. And I think curiosity is really an essential part of this journey that you're now beginning of academic scholarship and your thesis. And in terms of substance, I really liked what you said. So not emergency solidarity in a sense, but solidarity of emergencies. I think that's a very important message to all of us across many different policy areas, because of course the emergency is affecting so much and it risks doing so in a very fundamental manner.